Guys. Hi, I'm Daniel. I'm going to be taking you guys for the introduction to Maya. Short exercise we're going to do. Okay, just while we're waiting to get logged in, I'm going to go through, take you through some of the areas of Maya, just explain a little bit about it. Let's just fire up Maya. So, basically what we have within Maya is a node-based system. So whenever we create any content within Maya, we're actually creating a series of nodes. Each of those nodes have attributes that can be adjusted, and then those nodes and attributes can be connected to one another to affect an outcome. And once this boots up, I can show you an example of that. So even something as simple as creating a sphere. If I was to create a sphere, when I create that sphere, obviously it appears in the center of the screen, but actually what I've really created here is a bunch of nodes with different attributes. So if I take a look at these nodes, and there are more, I'm going to roll out. There you go. Okay, so actually creating a sphere, I've created some of these nodes or connected the sphere to some of these nodes that already existed. So things that this object needs to know, you know, that it exists, is first of all, it needs to know where it is in space, whereabouts in XYZ space. So it has this node here. This is known as a transform node. When I select it, it gives me attributes. So the node is selected. Now I have attributes that control its translation, its position in space, its rotation, its orientation, and its scale, its size, also its visibility. So that's one node. It now knows where it is in space. Now the next node along is known as a shape node, and I have one here. Now this doesn't have any animatable attributes that we can see here, but I can actually take a look at in more depth what this does. Basically, this is the object itself. This is what gives it kind of form, gives it a surface. So in here I have things to control things like how it's tessellated, how it's subdivided at render time, and how it renders. So if I wanted it to do things like cast shadows, reflection, and so on. So the shape node is basically the object itself. And then we also have this guy. This is the make nerves sphere node, so this was also created. Now this is basically a creation node that allows me to procedurally create this sphere. So this sphere was created by drawing a semicircle and then sweeping that semicircle around 360 degrees. So you see we have attributes things like start and end sweep, and by adjusting those attributes, let's just jump in here, change this. You can see I can change how far around that geometry has been swept. I can change the radius, which actually is me actually changing the size of that original semicircle. The bigger the semicircle, the larger it is once it's swept around. The degree, whether it's a faceted surface with hard edges or a cubic surface with smooth edges. And then finally, the number of sections and spans, number of subdivisions this object has been made out of. So as you can see, as I change these attributes, it affects downstream the rest of the outcome of what we see. Cool. Now, those are the only three nodes that were actually created. All of the other nodes that you see existed already, but our objects needed to be connected to them in order to have certain other characteristics. So such as this guy here, initial shading group. This is basically what gives our object a surface. And plugged into that we have landlock one, which is the actual material on that surface itself. So that's what is giving it this gray color. So without this, we wouldn't have an actual surface on this. And I can actually unhook that. If I deleted that, from here, you'll see now it doesn't have any shading or anything like that. It just turns a solid color. I'll just undo that. And then finally, it also needs to know things like which lights are affecting it. So there's a light linker that links the object to all the lights in the scene, and render partition, which controls whether it actually renders and how it renders when we hit render. But anyway, that's basically how Maya's working. Now, to be honest, a lot of this you're not going to need to worry about too much today, but this is all going on in the background. I'll just show you one more example in a little bit more depth. I mean, this was just creating a sphere, but if I did a number of geometry operations, so I'll take a bunch of points, chamfer them, crank that up like that, merge them, take some edges like this. One more. Convert to that, extrude. Build another one of those. And then take the whole result and smooth it. Make sure we got enough subdivisions. There we go. Bam. Okay, so I've made an interesting geometrical object there, but I started out with a sphere, and then I've done a number of separate operations that created separate nodes with attributes that I then adjusted. Now, the nice thing about this is, because of the node-based system that we use, we can go back in history and change various characteristics of the object. So, you know, earlier on we had things like the size of the sphere. Now, you can see these are all the operations. These are all of those nodes that I kind of collected as I was working through it. So my first thing was I create the sphere. That's the sphere there. Then I chamfered some of the points, which basically split the points off into four. That also adds a delete component, which deletes some points as well for you, but that's part of the chamfer. Then I took those points and merged them together, because the chamfer resulted in points that were on top of each other, which would have been a bit messy. Then I took a bunch of edges, converted them to faces, extruded those faces, extruded once again, so there's two extrusions here, and then took the whole result and smoothed it. Now I can go back and do things like change the original radius. I could change the size of the original sphere. Now you'll see that it's actually affecting the entire object all the way down the stream. So I can scale that up and down. I could do, scale up a bit more. I could do things like go back to those extrusions and I can change their characteristics. I can push the extrusions in rather than out, making a slightly different, interesting shape than that. Or I could go to the second extrusion and again play with that. So this is the kind of thing that was working in the background as you're working with Maya, because we have these nodes and we can go backwards in history. It allows us a lot of control, particularly when it comes to animation. I mean, all of these factors could be animated if I wanted to. So that's basically what's happening in the background. Now, just very quickly, yep. Everybody's logged in?
Brill.
Thank you. Just to very quickly show you, it doesn't always work out. There are some things that will kind of destroy your history, all of these inputs. Things like, if you imagine, in order to do some of these, things like these extrusions here, or these merges, I selected a number of vertices, or a number of faces, and then extruded and merged those points. Now, if I change the number of the original points of the original geometry, that's going to change the count, and all of those points are going to be shifted to different places. So, within reason, if I went down here and changed that to 10 subdivisions rather than 20, I mean, yeah, gets a bit messy. Let's try that the other way. That does that. Well, that's a slightly more interesting shape, but as you can see, yeah, there are certain things that will actually cause it to break. So within reason, we can work with these nodes, but after a while, it can break. We need to be careful of what we